I'm curious, as we begin to talk about change today, change in our lives, change in our church, our religious tradition, how many of you grew up in a Christian church of one kind or another? So you just raise your hand for a moment and keep your hand up, look around, and now add your hand, if you will, if your parents grew up in a Christian church. And just look around again. Thank you. So I think it's remarkable. I think it's remarkable what a dramatic break with the past this room of people represents. And what a dramatic break with the past has happened more widely in our culture in just a generation or two. There was a study a few months ago from the music provider, the online music provider, Spotify, said that on average, people stop listening to new music at age 33. I shared this with Emily when I first read it, and she grabbed my hand with a nervous look on her face and with some intensity said, "We can't end up like that. We have to keep listening to new music. And we'll do our best." But the truth is, change is hard. And from all the research, it appears that it just gets harder as we age. Once at a regional minister's gathering, we talked about that song that we sang earlier, "Enter, Rejoice, and Come In." We broke into a rousing rendition, that little circle of us, particularly when we got to that line, "Don't be afraid of some change." Oh, we just belted it out. And one of the ministers told us that he always makes them sing that verse twice. So it's a truism that change is often difficult and scary. But one of the insights from adaptive leadership, that's a fairly new body of work addressing change, is that it's not actually change that we fear. Change seems scary because it so often comes with loss. And it's the loss that we actually fear. Do you know that book, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, Robert Persig's book? It's full of little gems of wisdom. In one anecdote, he describes monkey traps. In South India, a monkey trapper will hollow out one end of a coconut, put a ball of rice inside, and then chain the coconut to a stake. A monkey smells the rice, reaches into the hole to grab the rice, but the hole has been deliberately made just big enough for the monkey's hand to enter, but not for a closed fist to leave. Because the monkey will not let go of the rice, it's trapped. Have you ever clung to the rice? Refusing to let go of something, the fear that we might have to give up what we know and love, what we trust, keeps us trapped, keeps us resistant to change. So the question is, of course, what is your rice? What is my rice as a community? What's our rice? What is it that keeps us trapped by refusing to let it go? What makes you want to say, what makes others, perhaps you've heard them say, you wouldn't, of course, "That's how we've always done things"? So a quick story about how we've always done things. You might have read some version of it. It's been circulated for a number of years on the internet. It goes like this. The standard railroad gauge in Canada and the United States, the distance between rails, is 4 feet 8 1/2 inches. Why such a strange distance? Well, you have to go back a few steps. Our train tracks were built by British expatriates, and that was the standard in England. And it was the standard in England because they were based on the old tramways, which were in turn based on using the same tools that were used for the wagons, which were set on a gauge of 4 feet 8 1/2 inches so that they would fit on the old wagon ruts in the road. And where did those old rutted roads come from? Well, the first long-distance highways in Europe were built by Imperial Rome. The ruts were made by Roman war chariots. 4 feet 8 1/2 inches was the width the chariot needed to be accommodating of the two rear ends of a war horse, right? The two. So our modern train tracks are all sized to perfectly accommodate the rear ends of two war horses. But it's how we've always done things. Now, actually, the truth is that there's some falsehoods in this story if you look it up. That George Stevenson, the engineer who established the standard gauge, did not measure precisely based on the ruts of the Roman war chariots. But the gauge, it was built on those existing roads and existing wagons. And so, actually, for the part of me that recoils at change, it's somewhat reassuring. No matter how enormous a change feels, it will always be built on, always be connected to that which has come before.
A few years ago, I was at a Unitarian conference at a hotel in Oakland, California. And we had set out a table with name tags on it for the participants. And I was standing there with a colleague of mine, a mentor, Reverend Barbara Hamilton Hallway. She's a very friendly, warm person. And we were giving out name tags, and a man and his son walked up to our table, and the son started playing with the name tags, rearranging them, and the father said, "Oh, no, don't do that." And in the process, he started chatting with us a little bit. And he said, "Well, what group are you with? What's your event?" And Barbara gave a big smile, and she said, "We're a church group." And his face fell. And he sort of guided his son gently away from the table. Let's give them their space," he said. And I wanted to jump across the table and say, "No, we're the good kind. love is the center of our theology. You don't need to be afraid or keep your children away from us." But the truth is, more and more people are leaving religious institutions, churches, synagogues, and mosques. Many people say that their new religion is the Sunday newspaper, or brunch, or soccer games. And so it is particularly true in urban communities, places like Vancouver. When people study and track these trends, they have taken to calling those whom do not belong to a particular religious group, nuns, not affiliated nuns. Of course, many of the nuns are people we know and we love. They're in our families, in our schools, and in our workplaces. In Canada and in the West Coast in particular, we are immersed in this dominant culture of no or little religious affiliation. Sometimes we may even feel shy saying, "I'm going to church on Sunday morning." And yet, so many of us choose to live in this place because we feel we are surrounded by people who share our values. So even as religious affiliation officially has declined, the spiritual and community needs of people persist. We all need space and time and support to nurture our connection to ourselves, to people similar and different from us, a place to rest and draw renewal from that larger sense of life that connects us all. Places where the whole self is welcome, where you can make room for the soul, can be few and far between in the 21st century. So while we live in this age of increasing digital connectivity, loneliness is on the rise. You can document this in the same way that you can document the decline of religious affiliation. When surveyed, most people said that they were struggling to name three people they could call when they needed a friend. Despite the number of friends they have on Facebook or followers on Twitter, how many contacts are in their phone, more connectivity has not necessarily led to deeper relationship. Practices and places that foster deeper relationship and reflection are essential to a healthy life, to a healthy civic society. Support and leadership in addressing the moral and ethical challenges of our time are essential to a functioning democracy. When we are in these places, invested in these communities, we truly are transformed. And in turn, we transform the world. Many religious traditions, particularly those with a fundamentalist slant, may look out at the world and see suffering or loneliness or injustice and violence, and may say that the root of this is evil or sin, a lack of belief in God or faith. As Unitarian Universalists, we look out at the world, and when we see this loneliness, this suffering, this injustice and violence, we recognize the source is disconnection. People are disconnected from one another, from their own innate sense of goodness, and from the larger relationship we have with all the earth. The purpose of our religious community is to heal this disconnection with connection. Connection allows us to discover our shared struggles and dreams, to collectively build power to create more beauty and more justice in the world. We are inheritors of a tradition for which some people have been tried and judged. They are criminals of innovation who said we need not think alike to love alike. So we know that church need not be a scary word, and religion need not be something that we need to shield our children from. So who is responsible for creating this environment we live in which people are leaving religion in droves? It is easy on the one hand to point the finger at coercive religions that have collaborated with empire and given the word a bitter taste. It's easy to blame fundamentalists for making religion synonymous with conservative. Easy to blame the Catholic Church for tracing indelible neural pathways between religion and hierarchy and domination. And in some ways, these accusations have solid ground. Yet it is harder and more important to acknowledge our own shortcomings. Too often, liberal religion has failed in not proclaiming that our way of being religious is essential to our livelihood. Too often, Unitarian Universalism has failed in defining our mission by squawking about all the ways we're not like those other bad religions. Too often, we have failed in capitulating to secularism, reducing our worship to lecture, refusing to engage with sacred text. And too often we have failed in cultivating a sense of religious identity with our children. Paradoxically, we are both too religious and not religious enough. So let's face it, while the church will continue to working well for a lot of good folks, there's also a lot of lonely people out there who could use a dose of the loving connection we offer, who would appreciate the quality of our community, and who already resonate with our values, but who simply will never come because we are a church.
So we refer to our tradition often as the living tradition, a living tradition, because we allow ourselves to change and be changed by the times. And one of those challenges to change, one of the reasons we cling so tightly to the rice, is that we can't know when we make a change, whether it will be for the best or whether it will lead us in the wrong direction. We can't know before we make the change. We can research and we can look at trends and deliberate and talk and consult wise people, and we can look at tea leaves or read tarot cards, but ultimately, change is an uncertain endeavor, inherently risky. With any real change, we cannot be certain of the outcome. We have to risk changing anyway, not knowing if we're making the right decision or not. And it's precisely taking the risk of change that we celebrate so many of our Unitarian heroes for, like Emily's been talking about, Francis David, tried and imprisoned for the crime of innovation. Beyond innovating to teach tolerance of other people's beliefs, his innovations were to question infant baptism, to challenge the worship of Jesus as a figure of God, to challenge the practice of communion. So we know that from the very beginnings of our tradition, we have been a dissenting voice, a voice of change. But unlike some of the other traditions with roots in that same period, roots in the Reformation, change became part of our DNA. We've only expanded on those heresies in the last 500 years. Theodore Parker, he was a 19th century transcendentalist in New England, one of our venerated UU heroes again. We lift up his work as a theologian. His essay, "The Transient and Permanent in Christianity," helped shape our departure from the Christian fold. We lift up his work as an abolitionist. It said he preached with a pistol in his pulpit in order to fend off slave hunters who might try and come find the escaped slaves who worshipped with him. And yet, for the very things that we hold up about him, the very things we celebrate today, he was ostracized by the Unitarians of his time. He was kicked out of covenant with the local ministers of the churches that he worked with. The change he brought was too scary, his stance on abolition too radical for many of the Unitarians of the time who were entrenched in the established status quo. What a wonderful and instructive change that we celebrate him today. And then even in just the last 100 years, our tradition has changed in radical ways. One small example, it would have bewildered our religious ancestors 100 years ago that today there's a Buddhist meditation group in almost every Unitarian Universalist church. We are not the people our ancestors thought we would be. Our hymnal, oh, it disappeared. Oh, I wanted that prop. Oh, great. Our hymnal, oh, beloved gray hymnal. It's another good window into these changes. I love it. I grew up with this hymnal. As a teenager, I learned to plan services by flipping through the back, finding songs and readings for the themes. I love the title, Singing the Living Tradition. I like the teal hymnal, too. A few songs in particular. I do, I really, I mean, that's some of my favorite songs there. But it's still the new hymnal. It's the supplement. Nothing like the familiar, heavy, gray safety blanket. Was anyone here a Unitarian before the gray hymnal? Yeah. You know, those prehistoric days before 1993 when this was published. You remember hymns for the celebration of life? Yeah. Anyone go even further back and remember hymns for the spirit? That was, yeah, a few folks. 1934, that one came from. This is from 34 to now, three generations of hymnals. So, Hymns for the Celebration of Life, that most recent one before this gray one. It was published in 1964, right after the Unitarian Universalist merger. It was full of patriarchal God language. He, him, Lord, Father, all of this. When feminism woke us up to the deep problems of this exclusive language, it reduced the usable portion of that hymn book from 327 hymns to 58. But change is scary. I can imagine so many people feeling about hymns for the celebration of life the way I feel about our singing the living tradition. It's not just a hymnal, it's the hymnal. It's my hymnal. It took till 1993 to update that language. And the truth is, now that we've got a gray hymnal and a teal hymnal, and actually there's a purple hymnal now too with Spanish language hymns, and there's a brand new, I guess it's not that new anymore, a new readings hymnal, I think it's black or red. There's enough hymnals that a new hymnal, a new main hymnal, is not far off. With so many congregations using screens to project the lyrics to hymns now, who knows what form the new hymnal might take? I think it's going to be a bit of a loss for me, giving up my gray hymnal. And I believe this loss, and other losses far greater, are the cost to be part of a living tradition. There are plenty of other traditions out there that are doing their best to move as slowly as possible, despite what changes in the world around them. And there is some degree of comfort, of safety, and stability there, I understand that. But here, change, and its attendant loss, is the price of the ticket.
So what change is afoot in this congregation? Where are we as a people going? As we began in September, Marcus and I wanted to gather with small groups of members and friends in this congregation to hear your stories. And we are beginning this initiative, as Marcus said, next Wednesday. It's called Hopes and Histories. And our goal is to hear from you about three questions we believe are essential to building this community and facing the changes ahead. First, we want to hear the stories of how has this place, this community, changed your life? How has it changed life on the North Shore community in Greater Vancouver? What is different for you as a person because of your being a part of this congregation? What has been the impact here on the North Shore of this congregation? Second, we want to know, as you go through everyday life, reading the news, sitting with neighbors, and conversations with coworkers and friends, what breaks your heart open? What injustice, what suffering, what crisis draws your attention, pulls at your being? That's not right. That's not the way it should be. And third, we offer this invitation to dream, and dream big with us. Imagine for a moment with me this scenario. We've completed our new building project, we've moved in, it's surpassed our hopes. It's finished, there's a long-term financial plan for caring for the building in years to come, and after creating a balanced budget, the board realizes we have $1 million in funds to spend. What would you propose? What initiative would you suggest that we work together on? How could we use this money to serve the world? We want to do a ministry that is meaningful and relevant in people's lives today. We want to be with you in this congregation that boldly lives our mission. We want to thrive, to be generative, transformative, a place where people find hope and move out into the world with courageous love. We want to hold on to what is good about what we do now and to innovate for a new generation of seekers. We want to meet people where they are, online, in the streets, face to face, and challenge them, all of us, to live with greater depth, meaning, and purpose. We envision a beloved community guided by the visions of ancestors such as Martin Luther Jr. King. Martin Luther King Jr. Where people of all identities find common ground among the sacred. A place where villages are built for families who need support, who are struggling with isolation. A hub, a lively community center where people know that art and music is central and woven throughout the program, that what they find and hear will be relevant to what they're facing each day. We dream of a community committed to showing up for vulnerable people and habitats, courageously taking a stand by directing energy and resources to amplify voices of the marginalized. We see children and youth leading the way, as they always do, reminding us of our responsibility to the coming generations. So what if?
What if the entrance to our new building was a bustling storefront cafe, easily welcoming in people seeking connection who would never think to visit a church?
What if we shared space with an Iranian Muslim congregation, an evangelical Korean church, and together we offered a tutoring program or served community meals?
What if we harnessed the skills and expertise of our members and became known as a go-to community for legal, financial, administrative assistance for nonprofit organizations in our community?
What if we celebrated the winter and summer solstice with our public art ritual and 500 people came?
Or what if perhaps we offered our OWL, our whole live sexuality education program to young people and families across the Lower Mainland in after-school programs and summer camps?
What if we collaborated with community leaders to advocate for a radical, affordable housing plan on the North Shore?
What if we designed and offered an age-appropriate substance use curriculum, offering young people and families the resources they needed to have hard conversations about drugs and alcohol?
What if our congregation was the source of the next generation of spiritual, economic, and political leaders on the North Shore, in British Columbia, in Canada? What if? It feels risky to share such big dreams with you, but the truth is we have to risk. We must risk, not only because of the changing culture, the changing trends, the changing attitudes about religion. We must risk because it is in our spiritual DNA. Not to risk would be to abandon ancestors like Francis David and Theodore Parker and all those who let go of the rice and changed to make what we have now possible. We have to honor the inheritance of a living, changing tradition, and like it or not, take a sip of water when we need it. Whew, I'm on fire. Okay. We have the honor of inheriting a living, changing tradition, and like it or not, it will always be asked of us to change more.
Before we end the sermon, as our choir will offer a beautiful piece of music, I invite you to enter that space of dreaming big dreams. Allow yourself to enter that liminal and risky place of what if, and see where it takes you. I once visited the Vatican with a class from seminary, and I'm a little worried now about making too many digs on Catholics, so I have to preface this now saying that some of the most inspirational folks I know are Catholic. I had a less than inspirational meeting with the undersecretary to the cardinal for interreligious affairs or something like that. Someone in our group asked him a question about why it was such a big deal that we had made this or that theological change, why that had meant we couldn't even share in communion with them. And this undersecretary to the cardinal, said with a heavy contempt in his voice, because then you have created a new religion. I remember thinking, well, it doesn't seem like such a bad idea to me. So to close, I want to share a book recommendation about creating a new religion. It's a favorite of mine. It's from my very favorite genre, theological science fiction. It's called The Parable of the Sower. And it's by Octavia Butler. She was one of the first and certainly the preeminent African-American women writing science fiction. And in The Parable of the Sower, a young woman struggles to survive and foster community in a dystopian future, in a United States led by a president who is now familiar. The main character, she's a daughter of a Christian preacher, but she takes what she has learned and fashions a new religion, a religion to meet the needs of her time. The core of her religion is simply this: God is change. Shape God. Scattered throughout the book are fragments from the imagined sacred text of this new religion. In one passage, Butler writes, "God is power, infinite, irresistible, inexorable, indifferent. And yet, God is pliable, trickster, teacher, chaos, clay. God exists to be shaped. God is change." In another, "Any change may bear seeds of benefit. Seek them out. Any change may bear seeds of harm. Beware. God is infinitely malleable. God is change. God is change. Shape God." Let's shape the change that is coming, whether we like it or not. Let's shape it as our spiritual ancestors have, shape it to serve life, to serve needs greater than our own. Let's shape our living tradition to be a vessel for our values to flourish, to create connection and meaning for the next generation of seekers to walk through our doors. May it be so. Amen.